thank you everyone so much for taking the time to join this webinar session. We do genuinely really appreciate you choosing to spend your time with us today. There are just some quick housekeeping bits before we just dive into the webinar. Firstly, the webinar is recorded, but will be sent to you after the session. Don't worry if you do have to drop out for any reason, you will still get the webinar in its entirety. Secondly, definitely do use the Q&A function in Zoom for your questions. As you've seen, we do monitor chat and we keep an eye on it, but questions can get lost in there, particularly if it's quite busy like it is today. So the best way to kind of get your questions answered is via that Q&A functionality. And then finally, we definitely encourage you to fill in the post-webinar survey. It's really helpful and does help us to tailor our webinars to share more of what you guys actually want to see from us. If I could get the next slide, please. Now that's all out of the way. You've now met me, just in case for whatever reason you did miss my introduction. My name is Francesca Ellis. I'm the support engineer here at Zappa. But without further ado, it is my absolute pleasure to hand over to Simon. And Simon is our Chief R&D Officer here, and of course, co-founder of Zappa. So welcome in, Simon.
Hi. Thank you, Fran. And thank you, everybody, for joining. It's great to see so many people here. This headshot is from an earlier and simpler time, pre-COVID and pre-lockdown hair, but won't dwell on that for too long. And let's not make the chat only about my hair. Thank you. All right, moving on. So the agenda we're going to cover today, I'm going to go through a quick introduction to world tracking, kind of what we specifically mean by world tracking in this webinar, at least. The real interest for us is world tracking in web AR, because that unlocks a lot of great opportunities for friction-free experiences for your users. We're going to show where we came from and then introduce our new and improved world tracker web AR implementation. A little bit of a live demo, and then Fran's going to talk you through how you can get started using this new beta implementation across all of our various supported SDKs and platforms. Okay, so world tracking. So world tracking AR allows users to place content, 3D content, in their environment and then have it appear like it's locked in position as they move around, so they can explore naturally. Either an interactive experience or a 3D model from various angles. To prevent the content from sort of looking like it's floating around, it needs to be positioned sort of aligned with a surface in the world. And so surface detection is another important part of a world tracking implementation. It potentially should be called more environment tracking or even camera tracking. Just want to make clear, we're not talking about world tracking as in geolocated AR experiences like Pokemon Go. Although for those experiences, potentially you could use GPS to trigger a locally world-tracked experience. But here we're talking about kind of mapping and placing content in the user's local current environment. So to get slightly more technical, you might have heard the phrase SLAM. That stands for simultaneous localization and mapping. Basically involves working out a map of things in the world around a user, a device, a robot, or whatever. At the same time as then localizing that user within that map that's being built. You can use all kinds of sensors for SLAM, and a lot of the early kind of research on it was from the robotics community, where they were using laser scanners and all kinds of things. But in the computer vision community, we often talk about monocular SLAM, which is using a camera, a single camera, as the input to that SLAM system. And with a single camera SLAM system, depth isn't actually, absolute scale isn't actually determined. So you can imagine me moving a device around a room and then moving a device around a scale model of the room, and the camera images would look identical. So there isn't enough information just in the camera images alone to work out scale. And so visual inertial odometry is another sort of option in the world tracking space, where you leverage the combination of motion sensors in devices along with images from the live camera view. You kind of fuse that data together. And that does allow scale to be worked out as long as the camera moves. Yes, cool. So world tracking kind of came to prominence for mobile AR with ARKit, which was iOS 11, which I guess was 4.5 years ago now, assuming it's, has been one release a year. And that kind of made world tracking AR experiences kind of mainstream. And Apple made some choices at that point about how they would expose world tracking. And their choices were that it would be absolute scale would be part of it. So all of your coordinates would be returned in meters. And in terms of how they did the implementation, it's a kind of combination of SLAM and visual inertial odometry and a sparse feature map initially. That's changed on more recent devices that also have a LiDAR sensor, which can help to fill in some gaps that you would otherwise get in the map. Google's AR Core kind of followed the approach that Apple laid out there. They'd initially worked on Project Tango, which was assuming sort of depth sensors, but now because Apple deployed this on monocular camera devices, Google kind of followed them with AR Core. And so then we had these native implementations that worked. They both work pretty well, certainly now they work quite well, and they're well supported across a wide number of devices. And because they followed similar, they exposed a similar kind of model for how their tracking worked, we were able to build a wrapper API inside Zapper Studio, and that's our world tracking API. And so with that API, you can publish content that you can scan in the Zapper app or in other native apps that have the Zapper embed component. And so those choices, it's great to have absolute scale for a lot of experiences. Some of them, it's crucial if you're trying to do, try and answer questions about whether a piece of furniture would fit in a room, then you need absolute scale. But the downside is, at least when you've only got one camera, it means you need to have some camera motion before you can start placing your content and having it in the right place in the world. So just a brief demonstration of this. So this is AR Kit on a device that doesn't have LiDAR. So this is going to be most users' experience of AR Kit with some content that I put together in Zapwork Studio using our world tracking API. So once you turn on plane detection, you can see that until the camera moves, AR Kit sort of knows nothing about the world at all. And then as the camera moves, it starts to detect here the floor and the wall. The wall's quite clever. I think it's based on it seeing the edge of the floor. That's definitely improved in more recent versions of AR Kit. You can see the white table when I move the camera back down again. It's sort of invisible to AR Kit because there aren't any visual features on it. And so that texture and that even that anchor when I've tapped on the table sort of seems like it's floating. And that's because it's positioned at the wrong depth. It's positioned on the floor rather than on the table where it should be. The other downside is walls. So even though technically these APIs do support vertical plane tracking, a lot of walls are quite white and featureless and empty. And it means in practice, the APIs struggle to detect the depth of those walls, and that means users can't really place content there. So that's native AR Kit. Apple, in recent years on their high-end devices, have introduced LiDAR sensors, which gives a kind of sparse set of absolute depth measurements of points. So it's not a really good dense depth camera, but what it is really good at is finding these big blank flat areas, such as the table or the wall in that example. So with LiDAR, the other benefit of it is it doesn't require camera motion to define the scale of the world because it can directly measure the distance to these surfaces. So it makes initialization much easier. So this is only available in native apps on iOS and only on the very few high-end devices. So most of your users won't get this experience. So this is my point here, really. You need to be careful about the majority of your users who probably won't have access to this high-end hardware. But if you do, it works really well. So if you can control your hardware and you don't mind a native app as a deployment method, then Apple's high-end devices with LiDARs are really nice, and AR Kit works really well on those. So that's a brief kind of AR Kit introduction. So AR Kit and AR Core popularized this idea that world tracking means absolute scale, and it means the wiggle, unless you've got LiDAR, means the starting wiggle that placed on a surface. But that's just one kind of approach to world tracking. It has some downsides around initialization. Vertical planes, we tend to avoid internally just because of how often there are big white gaps on walls. But with LiDAR, it can work really well. And you can build content for both AR Kit and AR Core. You can build it once and you can easily preview it and deploy it using the Zapper app or the Zapper embed component. But that's not really what we're here about. What we're really here about is how can we do world tracking without requiring an app install? So before I dive into WebIR, let's have a little exploration of other options there. So app installs obviously add friction to the user experience, and for small kind of bite-sized experiences, they're not always, users might not feel it's worth an app install and a little home screen tile for a kind of one-time, one-off experience. Especially now, thanks to COVID, nice, the one positive of COVID, QR codes are a thing again. And most native camera apps have now integrated scanning of URLs and QR codes and popping up an easy way to open a browser to that URL. So at least to get users, if you've got a display ad or a physical, a print or some physical objects, you can easily get a QR code on there and get users to a website. If you don't have anything physical, you can obviously just share a link to the web quite easily on however you want, social media or ads or whatever. You might have heard of WebXR, so it's definitely worth a mention. So this is a kind of an in-development specification for browsers that would expose those native world tracking implementations, so AR Core, currently, because it's only really available on Android in the mobile front. But they expose that to the web, at least some of the capabilities of AR Core are exposed to the web through WebXR. The big problem there is iOS doesn't yet expose this. There are some public noises that Apple are working on it, but we don't know anything about when that might drop, if at all, whether it will be enabled by default or anything. So right now, as of today, to target users on iOS, the only option really to access native AR kit tracking is by using Quick Look, but that's really a model viewing, it's designed around the model viewing use case. Works okay, but it's iOS only. The tracking's obviously good, AR kit quality, good tracking, but there's not much ability to customize the UI or the UX. And so outside of those limited model viewing use cases, it's not particularly useful. And you also need to re-implement something different for Android. So therefore, what we really need right now is a universal web AR solution to deliver cross-platform experiences that are consistent and that we only need to write once for both iOS and Android users. What we mean by web AR here, I put it in little quotes because I think we might have been the ones to coin the term. We kind of mean using low-level web APIs that are really universally supported everywhere. So that's for access to things like the camera and the motion sensors. And those APIs are generally available on all devices that we would care about. The kind of computer vision implementation is then run in the browser directly. So it's either in JavaScript or typically in WebAssembly, which runs a bit faster, but it's just effectively code that we can provide and that we've wrapped up into our Universal AR SDKs or into our Studio Web AR runtime. So world tracking, just using those low-level web APIs, does have a number of limitations versus a native implementation. We don't have full access to the hardware. There's a CPU performance penalty. There's higher overheads. There isn't always the timestamp data to correctly sync up motion sensor data with camera frames. And so there are a number of limitations that mean it's additionally challenging on top of building an API in the native world. However, the ability to reduce friction for users to get into the content means we can put up with some of those challenges, and that potentially we don't need to match the kind of native level of performance in order to deliver kind of useful and valuable experiences to users. So with that in mind, we released back in 2020 our first kind of instant world tracking implementation for the web, which had its share of limitations, but it did allow instant placement of content. So that's one advantage of not needing scale to be defined, is that users can instantly place content and it will follow the texture underneath the object. It had some assumptions, this implementation, so it assumed that the plane that you placed the content on was horizontal and was pretty well textured. And also that placement point, so the bottom of the vase here, needed to stay inside the camera view at all times, really, in order for it to track properly. So that was quite a big limitation, but it did allow a set of world tracking experiences to be possible in the web. So that was where we were in 2020. And since then, in the vision team, myself and my team, we've worked really hard to effectively re-implement that same instant tracking concept, but with a much more general underlying approach, more of a SLAM-based approach. So now we have a ground-up re-implementation, which is constantly refining the depth of points in the world. It's no longer assuming that they're all on that horizontal surface that we've placed the content on. And that allows us to allows much more freedom in user motion. So now users don't have to keep that initial anchor point in view. And so that previous content I showed was built in Zapper Studio with our instant tracking API. And this is actually exactly the same content, but using our new runtime. You can see the URL at the bottom there, wtbeta.arweb.app. So if you've got any instant track studio content, you can just go and try that out in there immediately. But you can see the difference here now. So once I let go of the screen, it will lock into position on the rug. Perfect world tracking rug, I will note. Nice lot of textured features there. But we don't actually require that many horizontal textured features with this new implementation. You can say I can walk beyond the vase and it stays in position. I can go through the handle there and turn around and it's still positioned kind of in the same place, give or take where it was placed. So this is our new world tracking for WebIR implementation. And because we've now removed a lot of the limitations of the previous one, we think it unlocks way more experiences that should now be possible to deliver in the web. Next up, I'll try and show you live as well. So my trusty iPod here. So this is the latest generation iPod, but it's effectively iPhone 7-ish hardware, slightly underclocked. So it's low end on the iOS spectrum. And we tend to use these to kind of verify that we're gonna be able to offer good performance across all iOS devices. I can swap to share that now. And so when we initially shared a very first build of this updated implementation just before New Year, specifically in our standalone SDK for 3JS. And so this is the demo that I shared in my forum post there. I'll just refresh the page so you can see the load is pretty quick. We need to give access to the camera and motion sensors. I think it's remembered the motion sensor permission from last time. And you can see this is placement mode here. So in this mode, we're constantly calling the API. Fran's gonna go through the API in a second, but we're constantly calling the API to reset the position of this anchor, which is in between the shadows of the feet here. So we're positioning that relative to the camera and with an orientation that means the robot is gonna face me. So he's always upright with gravity, but he's facing me in orientation. And then when I tap the place button, we're gonna stop calling that API and then the world tracking implementation will take over. There's a nice wooden table, good for tracking. We don't need this many features now with the new implementation. We do need a feature near the anchor point. So I'll go for, say, that little knot there. And now he's landed, we can move around. We can move sort of left and right. We don't have to worry about keeping him in view. He drifted a little bit there, but he sort of relocked onto the position once his feet were still in view. And yeah, we can go inside his head over there. Yeah, so there he is in position and tracking relatively well. We can pick him up and place him again. The other thing we can show here is that scale is sort of defined by the distance from the camera that we do the initial placement. So if I go really close to the table and place there and then come back, then he's going to be smaller now versus if I was to place him over here in the world, then he's going to stay big. Okay. Is the end of that. How do I get back now? Resume share. No. Should have been the end of that.
We've got some great comments about that coming in, Simon, saying it's looking great.
Thank you.
Lovely. Thank you guys so much for your comments. Great to see what you guys are all thinking so far.
Okay, we're back. Right, I think, so some limitations that I want to talk about. So we saw it a little bit there where there was a moment of drift on the table and then it reattached when it found a new feature. So we're kind of prioritizing smoothness over long-term accuracy or drift. So with ARKit and AR Core, you'll see if you can, it's kind of a torture thing, I guess. Computer vision engineers around the world probably did when ARKit and ARCore came out. You can try and torture the implementations a bit and see how they respond. So one way is you capture the camera, so you effectively do that to it, and you move around and you can see when it stops trusting motion data. And then if you look back where you place the anchor, it's probably drifted at that point, and then you might see it redetect where it was and it will jump back. So that's called relocalization generally. So we're not currently doing any of that. We're kind of prioritizing this frame-to-frame smoothness and reattaching where we can to texture that's there. It's kind of similar to how other web AR world tracking implementations have also handled anchor reattachment. And so that reattachment at the moment is that anchor point. So the anchor point is still a little bit special, even though there's a more general map underneath it and you can look away from the anchor point. The anchor point is a bit special when it comes to keeping things well locked onto the world. So it's still probably best for the kind of use cases that worked okay before and they will work better now. For really large scale stuff like portals, which I'm sure is something that has probably already come up in the chat. Maybe it's worth waiting for another couple of milestones in our beta branch. And we'll talk about that in a second in the roadmap. We still need a feature near the anchor point. It's sort of true of most world tracking, unless you've got LiDAR, and there's none of the LiDAR data is exposed on the web anyway. So most implementations will have the limitation that you do need that visual texture. The interesting thing with the instant placement is if a user does try and place it somewhere that doesn't have visual texture, it will potentially look a bit floaty, but then when it floats next to a bit of texture, it will lock on. So it's a bit of a, it's not as ideal as you get with LiDAR, but it also prevents users sort of standing there forever trying to get a surface detected that will never be detected. So you could argue it's a UX improvement, or you could argue the opposite, and feel free to argue at will on that one. And as I mentioned and demonstrated, absolute scale isn't known. It's sort of defined by that initial placement position of the camera relative to the camera. And so it was, let's say the robot was one unit high and he was positioned three units in front of the camera, something like that. So units are sort of arbitrary. So let's talk about the roadmap, because some of these are hopefully not going to be long-lived limitations. So we've got lots of general performance and quality improvements being worked on. That have been being worked on for a while, and as and when we're happy with them, we will be rolling out updates to the beta branch with those new things. Also the much sort of broader world understanding unlocks a lot of new APIs that we are planning to add around instant tracking, so multiple anchors, surface detection, so exposing planes, at least horizontal planes are relatively straightforward, and that will probably be first. This is a specific case of horizontal planes is ground planes. And this comes back to kind of portals, where generally portal experiences do need a large area to work on. And so they generally are best sort of outdoors in parks or something where you do have a nice continuous ground plane that's a single level and that we can detect and move around. And so there's probably a targeted API for those use cases where we would do some of the reattachment logic, but in a way that would keep the ground of the portal attached across a larger space, rather than having a single anchor point being important. And then extended tracking. So this idea is to use one of our other trackers, generally image tracking. You could use a Zap code. We also have some new markers coming with Zapbox, which can be printed really small and still detected. So they're an interesting candidate there. So for this, you would initialize your tracking from an image, say, that you're tracking. You'd initialize your content from that. But then as the user moves away and the image moves out of view, we could hand over to this world tracking implementation to continue tracking the user. And an interesting thing about extended tracking is because as long as you know the scale of that image that you're tracking, you then know the scale of the content. So that sort of is one way of solving the scale problem as well. We are also looking at the feasibility of doing scale detection with the limitations of the web platform. So effectively, it comes down to trying to figure out from accelerometer data exactly how far the user's moved as they move the camera like that. In the web, we have lower precision accelerometer data and also lower sample rate data. So I'm not going to promise yet that it's going to be possible, but we are looking into it. And if it's feasible, we will do it and bring it out. We are also, for Zapbox, as I mentioned, we're using this natively, so we will be writing that code anyway. So hopefully it will also be possible on the web, even if a slightly lower quality scale estimate. Yeah, I think that's it for me. I'm going to hand over now to Fran to talk about how you can get started using the API.
Lovely. Thank you so much, Simon. So that was a fantastic look, kind of all about the history of world tracking. Of course, we've now seen a little bit of it in use. We've seen a few videos. We've seen that awesome live demo. So let's actually go ahead and talk about the API now, and also how you can get started with your own improved world tracking for WebAR experiences. So right now, there's just a single key function to set the anchor position relative to the current camera. So that's kind of what you were seeing with Simon's robot there. And then, of course, there are a selection of orientation options. So for those of you who might be familiar with developing with the Instant Tracker, either in Zapwork Studio or indeed with our Universal AR SDKs, you might see that these look pretty familiar. You'll notice that the Instant Tracking type has that recognizable name. And of course, we're using that set anchor transform from camera to kind of get that scale and of course that position from the camera there. And indeed, just a little note there that Z position should be negative. And the reason for that is because that is what sets that scale of the world by defining the distance from the camera to the world features next to that anchor. So that common approach to that placement UX is to call out every frame during what we like to call placement mode. So that's what kind of keeps that object or your the content you want to track kind of moving around with you whilst you're attempting to place it. But of course, there are some other UX approaches that can be built with this simple underlying API. Something before we move on that's super important to kind of get across is that you can develop your experiences as normal, as you normally have been with the Instant Tracker, with this kind of existing object type. So you don't have to change your development behavior when creating a new experience. You just have to make sure that you are targeting kind of the correct branch, and we'll kind of go over that in the next couple of slides now. So let's go ahead if we have the next slide here. Just a quick warning here before we carry on. We should make clear, and we've kind of spoken about a couple of times now, the fact that this is indeed on what we call a beta branch. And that means that we are continuously working on it in order to make improvements, but therefore it's not really recommended for live projects. But of course, you are kind of in control of your own experiences. So if you're using the Universal AR SDKs, you should make sure that you're pinning a version that you are happy with for your deployments. And as usual, make sure that you're testing rigorously whenever you're updating your dependency. That's across devices and of course browsers as well. Super great news that we have we are able to do this for Studio as well. So for Zapwork Studio experiences, we recommend deploying with a custom WebAR site, and that's because we can pin kind of a particular version of the implementation in the same way that you might do for Universal AR SDK, just to make sure that it's kind of as stable as it can be. But of course, you can test your new world tracking beta experiences, and we'll let you know how to do that just in a couple of moments now. Awesome. So now that's out of the way. Let's begin. So I'll first kind of go over the Universal AR SDKs. And the reason for that is because the beta branch kind of came out earlier. We do have a Get Started with Improved World Tracking and the Universal AR SDK forum post on our documentation site. Hopefully we can grab someone to kind of pop that in the chat. And there are kind of a few ways depending on the different kind of tool or library that you are using. Today, since we are kind of talking about getting started, we'll be kind of putting a focus on new Universal AR projects in this webinar. I can kind of briefly go through how you can update your existing projects, as I'm sure many of you will, but for more information, definitely head over to that forum post there. Cool. Let's go ahead and talk about our web SDKs. So, to get started with our web-based Universal AR SDKs, and of course the improved world tracking for web AR, super easy, simply follow the usual instruction steps for your chosen library. And of course, it would be amiss of me not to mention the documentation site, that's doc.zap.works. And of course, when you go to add the npm command, you want to add at beta. So something that should be made aware is that for now, at least the web SDKs, world tracking for web AR is only available via npm. But as you can see, it's pretty simple to install. If you are familiar with using npm and kind of installing our packages this way, it shouldn't look too different to you. All we're doing is adding that at beta kind of tag at the end there. So ordinarily, if I wanted to use the Zapler 3.js package without the beta, I would just do npm install -save at zapper/zapper-3-js. But if I kind of want to improve and have a bit of a play with the beta branch, I can just add that at beta with just a couple of types. If you are updating an existing project, all you need to do is uninstall the kind of the current version of the library that you're using. And then you can just use this command as it's kind of displayed here. If you want to, you can also edit your package.json. Again, more information on that will be in the forum post. Let's go ahead and talk about
again, Fran.
Yeah.
I know you have mentioned it, but just to be 100% clear, at the moment, from a content perspective, this is exactly the same API that our previous instant world tracking implementation was using. So swapping. You can kind of swap back and forth if you want to see how well your content works with the new one, and go back to the old one if you find something not working as well as you want. But please let us know if you find that, because we'll certainly start using this for our own deployments internally. And yeah, we think it's a big step forward. But for sure, you don't need to update the content at the moment. So you can pretty quickly swap between implementations just by changing your dependencies for Universal AR, or by swapping which sites you're using for the Studio Web AR sites. As we move forward with the roadmap, obviously we're intending to add some more API surface, so then it will get harder to swap back, but by that stage, things will be stable and brilliant across the board, obviously. So no one would want to go back. Why would you want to? Join us in the future. Okay. Cool, thank you. Next.
Yes, thanks for clarifying that as well. Yeah, super important. Basically, just because you are kind of adding that beta tag, you don't have to do anything extra in your projects. All your content will stay the same. You're just linking to a different version of the library, if that makes sense. So to kind of show that with the Unity SDK, all you need to do is, again, follow the usual instructions that are on the docs and add hashtag beta on the end of your Git URL import. So again, we have an example of that there. Just the usual URL, we've just added that hashtag beta to point to that particular branch. And you can define the Universal AR Unity package as a dependency in your project's manifest.json file if you want to as well. That's similar to a package.json. Again, more information about how you can kind of add those dependencies in that file on the SDK documentation. But if you did want to update an existing project, simply go ahead and just follow the normal installation instructions and just put that hashtag beta at the end there as well. Cool. So So for the Play Canvas SDK, simply fork the beta project. So pretty simple. We have a link to this on our documentation, as well as on that handy dandy forum post as well. If you are updating a project that already uses Universal AR for Play Canvas, all you want to do is just find your scene settings, and there'll be a tab that says external scripts. One of the dropdowns will have the existing Zapper JavaScript file. And all you want to do is kind of make sure that you're pointing to the beta version instead. And you can find an example of that on the forum post as well. So you can just copy and paste it if that's easier for you. Lovely. Next slide, please. Yep, so just to kind of round this section for the Universal AR SDKs off, for more information and to fully discover kind of step-by-step how you can update your existing projects or of course get started with a new project, go ahead and head over to the forum. The Getting Started with Improved World Tracking and Universal AR SDK kind of has a nice, handy, clear, full guide on each of the SDKs kind of formatted really nicely for you. And of course, the documentation itself, docs.zap.works/universal-ar as well, to pick your particular library. Also, we have updated many of our existing examples. So definitely go and have a nosy on our GitHub or of course on the example projects library too. So you can have a look at how we might use them kind of in practice in real time. Lovely. So that was all about the Universal AR SDKs. Now let's go ahead and talk about Zapbook Studio, which is super exciting. So yeah, any content built with Studio Z.Instant Tracker is also compatible with the new implementation. Again, probably stressing it a lot, but it's a really handy thing that you don't have to kind of change the way that you develop or change your behavior or change your content. All you need to do is just make sure that you're kind of linking to the right place. So if you want to test your new and improved world tracking experiences, just have a regular kind of Z instant tracker experience, and then go to wtbeta.arweb.app and then scan your Zap code to try it out. And that will be kind of the place where you can have the correct implementation. And then, of course, as we mentioned earlier, we can then deploy that version to kind of runtime, to kind of like official deployments, to any custom WebAR sites for something a little bit more permanent there. And indeed, we do have more information about the API itself on the forum there. And it's the instant tracking WebAR beta example content and API discussion. So definitely hop along over there and we can have a great chat. And we also do spend some time on the forum as well. So if you do have any questions, we're happy to answer whatever we can. Lovely. So with that, I think I might hand you back to Simon, and it's time for some Q&A.
Yeah. See, George, George has been marking some of the Q&As.
Awesome. Thank you so much, George.
Maybe we're going to have a live George.
No. Yeah.
Studio to be remaining muted. All right, maybe he means yes. I'm going to answer live. So thanks.
Okay.
Thanks for that. Yeah, great. Thanks for all the chat during that, everyone. And I hope it was instructive. So where to start? George, maybe you want to pose the questions.
Hello. I can do. Cool. Let me scroll all the way to the top. We had some great questions. Hello, everyone. I've been doing my best to answer some of them as they come in, but there's been quite a few. One from Larnell quickly. Can we use 3D models? I've answered this in the chat anyway. Yeah, you have full control over the feature set and the functionality based on the tool that you decide to use. So if you decide to use Studio, then you've got all of the Studio functionality, which includes things like animated 3D models. And if you decide to use one of our Universal AR SDKs, let's take Unity as an example, you have full control over the Unity function set as well. So particle systems and the timelines and et cetera, everything that you would normally see in Unity or any of them tools. So yeah, really nice one there. We had a couple again. I know we mentioned it already, Simon. You might want to go through this again, but the real world scale question that pops up every now and then. I know we mentioned the scale, but did you want to just go through that one more time just to make sure that question's answered?
Yeah, so it's in pure world tracking, so when we're just using the camera data in the web, we don't yet have either the implementation or necessarily confidence in the quality of the data that the web platform exposes to use the accelerometer to determine real scale. So right now, pure world tracking experiences in web AR are in arbitrary scaled units, and it depends where you place the content, kind of how far the actual surface is scaled by whatever that factor is. One option that definitely is coming to the roadmap soon, so we will also look at how well we can extract scale data from accelerometer data exposed to the web, but because it's not the full quality and sample rate you get natively, it might not be possible. So regardless of doing it in pure vision, in pure well AR scenarios, one way that will definitely work is with extended tracking, which is not yet exposed through the API, but is something coming during this beta process. So with that, you would use an image target or a marker-based target to define the origin and also therefore the scale of the content, and world tracking would just sort of pick up where image tracking fails once the image moves out of the field of view of the camera. I can show a little just because I love plugging Zapbox at every opportunity. Let me speed through here. So Zapbox, which is our very affordable mixed reality, virtual reality headset, now including these lovely electronic controllers, motion sensors in there, lots of inputs, Oculus Quest compatible set of inputs as well. The reason for showing this in this talk is because we're using these D3 markers, which are a new marker type that we've developed. And these can be tracked when they're really small in the camera image. So they're a good candidate for a marker that you might be able to use to start a kind of correct scale world tracked experience, potentially on something like a business card, a kind of really small marker that might then be able to spawn a coffee machine, or you know, that kind of scale factor should be possible with this marker type. And there's also some blank space in the middle, which you can then insert logos if you want, or a QR code to the experience. So it's potentially a nice way of giving a small physical target that will then allow accurate scale estimation. And we'll be using it a lot for Zapbox, which you can find more out about at that website there, and you can pre-order now.
Nice, right. Thank you, Simon.
Enough plugging of Zapbox.
One thing to mention, the forum had a 502 error as I was sending a link. Not sure why, but I think it's back up. I will share that link again to the forum post to explain how to get started and how to convert existing projects. But yeah, hopefully it's back up. It's never a webinar without a technical issue, so all good fun. Another one from Howard. Hi, Howard. Might be one for you, Simon. Is there a way, or is there going to be a way, maybe on the roadmap, of a way to expose the tracking quality and a way of maybe telling users that this isn't a good place to put your content just on a plain white table?
It's definitely a good idea. And I think there was a forward post from Howard about this as well that I replied to there with a bit more detail. But it's definitely something that I think would be worthwhile. Right now we have the requirement that there is that one kind of pretty strong feature near the anchor. During beta, we'll look to kind of try and extend, try and relax that requirement a bit. So if there does happen to be a well-textured plane as well, then you can probably stick it in the middle of that plane and it will probably be on the surface. So the actual requirements are evolving a little bit in terms of what you need to have a good placement point. But yeah, it's definitely a good idea to think about how we can expose an API for what the current quality is right in front of the camera at the current moment.
Nice. Thank you. Scrolling through the Q&A. If you do have any questions, we've got 10 minutes or so left, so please do fire away. There were a few questions, and I know we mentioned it, and Fran, I think you mentioned it throughout. There are a few early on about supported devices, and I guess supported browsers. I'm happy to answer that one. We've tried our best to make it as performant and as supported on as many browsers as possible. We do have a bit more of a in-depth list on our documentation site, which I'll also share, but the main browsers and the kind of pre-installed browsers that you get on most mobile devices should work without any issues. Obviously older devices may see a bit of a performance hit, but we've done our best, and we've obviously been around for a while, so our technical implementation was working on said older devices back in the day, so it should work without any issues and should be pretty performant. I don't know, Simon, if you have anything to say on that.
There's definitely ongoing work all the time to kind of measure and improve performance where we can, so both on improving kind of WebAssembly implementation, so making use of some of the more modern WebAssembly features, so you can access some of the SIMD operations now and CPUs through WebAssembly, at least in Chrome, so we're looking at leveraging that. Chrome have also improved their camera pipeline, so they offer a different way of getting access to the pixels in camera frames, which has lower overhead, so we're constantly evolving our code across all of our tracking types to be as performant as we can. Yes, although browsers are also constantly changing, and so you know, Apple could come out with something and that has a horrible performance on our code for some reason. There's constant everything's moving all the time, but our target is to constantly make things better on browsers people are currently using. There's a question there from D. Alex Butler about how quickly wheel tracking forgets about the existing model if chairs or furniture move. So right now it's a really, really very forgetful. And as soon as you're not looking at stuff, it sort of forgets about it. It will probably retain a bit more memory of the local space, but it will reject features pretty quickly if they're not in line. So it will try and find the set that seem kind of consistent and will then, just drop those features if you moved a chair or something. Effectively, it's I guess it's the same thing with the idea of the content kind of reattaching as it finds new features. The kind of overarching idea is that it should be it should follow camera motion pretty smoothly without necessarily sort of jumping back to or even trying to find something that was previously anchored to and jumping back to it. Different with extended tracking, of course, because extended tracking, your content is defined relative to the image. So as soon as the image is back in view, you would expect it to jump back and align itself properly. Wheel tracking, I haven't written it down on the roadmap there. We are interested in adding a mode to anchors that would make them a bit more long-term and that would then have that effect of jumping back when they're re-seen. But right now it's the kind of instant tracker best effort to stick to what's currently underneath it is kind of easy way of describing what the goal is, I guess.
Nice. Rostel asks, is it possible to put more than one item down, more than one piece of content down?
Yeah, so that would be the multiple anchors part of the roadmap. So that is something on the roadmap. Right now it's a single anchor, although I guess you could place things relative to that one anchor. You could potentially place two things with the current API. But in future we would have two anchors and they would then independently do that thing of locking onto the texture that's underneath them.
Nice. There's a few similar to the answer I gave earlier about things like shadows and adding sound and animations and touch swipe and all of these things. Yes, they're all possible. I believe the example that Simon showed was developed in 3JS and they have a nice way of exposing shadows, which is nice and easy to set up and something that the Universal AR tool suite do quite nicely. So yeah, things like shadows, and you can implement touch to swipe and drag to swipe and all of these things. And I know Fran's been playing around with creating a nice and easy to use 3JS useful package for things like touch to swipe. So we're always creating useful packages and trying to simplify this development process. So yeah, all of these things are definitely possible. It just depends on the tool that you decide to use and how that implementation is done in that specific tool. What else?
Yeah, there's a few questions again which come down to the tool around having the same instance viewable by multiple people from different places. So that one, I guess there are two parts to that. Do we support sharing an anchor between those people? So looking at a place in the world and having the content anchored in the same place for those different users. No, currently not. Again, with instant tracking, with extended tracking, you could use a marker or an image target to achieve that. And then the second part is the content side. Does the content engine support synchronizing experiences between users? Zapwork Studio doesn't out of the box do that. But some of our universal AR supported SDKs, such as Unity, would allow you to build those things. I'll do a few quick fire ones. Does iOS Chrome allow camera access yet? Yes. Third party browsers on iOS have allowed camera since, I think, 14.2. So that applies to Chrome, and it also applies to the in-app browsers and the social media apps. So it's not only Safari anymore, which is nice. Someone asking, could we do it with a Raspberry Pi? That's going to be a no. So one of the requirements is a gyroscope sensor for motion data, for orientation change. And Raspberry Pis, I don't think, have that. So that probably wouldn't work. It would be interesting to try in the Raspberry Pi browser if our other tracking types work, like potentially image tracking would work. I don't know how well the web APIs have been exposed through Raspberry Pi.
Yeah, that's to say, there's a couple on there about desktop browsers as well, and similar answer.
Yeah, so on desktop, world tracking isn't as appropriate on desktop, really, because you've got to fit your device up and move it around, and it's mirrored, and it's not generally great. Tablet devices are a bit hit and miss in terms of whether they include gyroscopes or not. All iPads do, so the iPad is fine. I think some of the Windows tablets that are more like laptops that just have had the keyboard removed, they maybe don't consider them as mobile devices, and they maybe don't have gyros. So it kind of comes down to that. The device in that case. Our other tracking types don't rely on motion data, so you can do face tracking experiences on desktop, or you can do image tracked experiences. Or marker tracked when we have the D3 marker I showed for Zapbox in, that would be another option. Depth, so people mentioning depth, I think what people probably mean by that is the sort of, like the AR core offers a depth map alongside the camera. That is going to be pretty challenging to do on the web, I think. So I haven't mentioned it on the roadmap. It's definitely not in this current version. That's potentially something that WebXR is more likely to be able to offer, where it has the full kind of power of the native device to do some of those calculations. There was a question on the bandwidth requirements of the API. So it's the API itself, all of the code is running on the device in the browser. So there's no bandwidth requirement at all, really, for the experience. So once you've loaded all of the content, then it can run without any connectivity at all. Obviously, if your content does involve some kind of server component or that multi-user component, then you're going to need some connectivity. But generally, once you've downloaded all of the assets, you can disconnect from the internet and it will still give you the experience. Yeah, question about portals. Thank you. I wasn't expecting the portal question. So portals, I've actually got a thing on portal. Portals do make for good videos, and they're cool outside. They do have pretty huge space requirements. This is some content that we built. Am I sharing this still? Yeah. As part of a Legoland project. You can see it's probably got 2 or 3 meters in front there, and the portal is dominating because it's the circular space dominating the view there. So this is a native app. This is using ARKit probably to do the tracking. And then Matt's made it through the portal, but is just about to walk into a hedge there where the video cuts, which is a shame because that would have been amusing. But obviously you've then got to go through the portal quite a long distance again to be able to turn around and then not have the portal dominating everything you see. So you need a big space. But outdoors, where you've got a big space and you've got a ground plane, then that milestone that I've spoken about, where we have anchors that are specifically sort of ground anchors that will reattach along the ground as you move around, that's the one that I would personally wait for before trying to do portals. But as you saw with the VARS demo, I was able to kind of walk past it and around and back, and it sort of works. So feel free to try. But I think for me, I would be waiting until that next milestone. Nice. Can we use AirCore with the SDK combined? So AirCore, native AirCore, with Zatwork Studio, you can use it with our other tracking types alongside AirCore powered world tracking. In the web with WebXR, I need to see if there have been any recent extensions, but at least the initial WebXR support was quite opaque when it came to the camera. So there was no way for our code to get access to the camera pixels. So WebXR is its own sort of separate runtime. Certainly our tools were interested in also supporting WebXR, especially if Apple do make progress towards releasing their implementation. And yeah, I would love to see a WebXR API that allowed us to also layer on top additional computer vision, such as the extended tracking, for example, from our D3 markers. But yeah, right now, natively, yes, AirCore with our content and our tracking SDKs possible on the web, no. Okay.
Nice. I was just going to say, if anyone wants to continue the discussion or ask us any more questions or have a play, do head over to our hopefully not broken forum and post on the threads there, and Simon, myself, Fran, or any other members of the team, we'll get back to any questions you have, and we can chat to you there. And we'd love to see some examples of new and improved world tracking in action.
Definitely.
Yeah. Thanks, everyone.
Definitely.
Cool. See you on the forum.
All right.